All praise to the Most High, Yah. So we are back, and let's continue where we left off. Again, we're honoring our African Heritage Month and giving praise to the Most High for how He has blessed us as a people, and how He has determined to lay His foundation of righteousness through the family, and how we are supposed to carry down that righteousness, starting from the head who is the husband, who is to be over the family, giving us the land of Africa that He blessed so richly with all the minerals and natural resources, right? First, He gave us the earth and the land, air to breathe, animals, plants, water, created us humans in His image, gave us all different types of resources in the land of Africa, and made us in His image. And then, again, the Father's the head. He's the provider. He's the person who provides security to the family, spiritual leader. And again, so Joseph took his family to the feast. We have to keep the feast days, honor our mother and father, right? Commandments, keep the commandments. We come from vast empires, and this is what the family is supposed to be, an intact family. And yet we were kidnapped from Africa, taken from our land, from our homeland, brought to the Americas, and the family has been under attack since, as you can see here. And it starts with the head. Of course, they're going to attack the man first. Like when you have a headache, your entire body seems to ache when you have a headache. It's the head. It's like, you know, they want to destroy the family, and they know the main target is the man, right? So the divide and conquer tactic. You see here, we have a woman. She has 1, 2, 3, 4 children, and she's all by herself struggling, trying to make it. This is what this picture is depicting, right? And we have this woman here. She has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I don't see a woman. Wait a minute, these are all children. There are no parents here, right? So destabilizing the family, right? Even in the land, there's destabilization of families, right? Because resources are taken away. Men are dying in war. They're dying from sickness. And they're just under attack. Some are just walking away. So this divide and conquer tactic is the black on black crime, which is also destroying our families. So we know that the resources have been confiscated. They are continuing to be confiscated from the oppressors, from the captors, from those who are stealing, right? We know who they are. They come into the land and they steal the resources. And all of this is destabilizing the family. And they are reaping the benefits. As the book of Deuteronomy 28 talks about, that other nations are going to come into the land and they're going to be reaping the benefits, while the people of the land are going to be facing famine, sword, and disease. So let's review the 13th, the 14th, and 15th Amendments, right? This is the Constitution, right? The Constitution, which at one time said that so-called blacks were 3/5 of a human being. So it was passed during Reconstruction, when the radical Republicans controlled the United States Congress, right? The 13th Amendment banned slavery in the US. 14th Amendment granted citizenship to former slaves, right? Weren't even citizens. 15th Amendment gave former slaves the right to vote. So this is the history of the Constitution. Slavery was banned with the 13th Amendment. 14th Amendment, slaves were considered to be citizens. 15th Amendment, slaves were given the right to vote. And has that helped us at all? Right? Not that much. Still treated like second-class citizens, and like we're not even citizens of the U.S., right? Like aliens, as they call people who are not considered to be citizens, who are not citizens, they call you aliens. Like you're not even human, aliens. Black-on-black crime is destroying the families as well. As you see this picture here, is a brother man pointing a gun at another brother man. And it's this says, shame really get you. Shame you, you get Brown away and Al Sharpton, Jesse Jackson, and Barack Obama won't say a single word on your behalf, and nobody marches. So this picture is saying that if Black people kill Black people, nobody really cares, or we don't show as much frustration and anger, and we don't march, right? But that's not completely true, because there are some marches that are occurring when so-called Black people kill Black people. How about Tyree Nichols, right? Was murdered by so-called Black police officers, right? Murdered him viciously, and it's being televised, right? Plastered all over the news now, and there's a lot of protesting going on. So Black on Black crime is destroying the family, right? More marches against police brutality, but less outrage over Black on Black crimes. Egyptians will fight Egyptians. That's in the book of Isaiah 19. Black people will fight Black people. The Bible talks about it. In fact, all throughout what people call the Old Testament, there's Black on Black crime, constant fighting. These people are mostly African people, right? And that, you know, we call ourselves Hebrew, Israelites, Bantu, and their brothers and sisters oftentimes. Israel fighting Judah, Black on Black crime. Philistines, they were enemies, but they were Africans too. All right? Syrians, these are all African people, right? Fighting each other, fighting against themselves. The Egyptians fighting against the Israelites, right? Constant war. Now let's continue. So the penalty in this chapter is idol worship. Idol worship is the reason why these horrors are happening to the people of the Most High. They've forsaken the Most High, right? So idol worship is the reason for all these horrors. And so the penalty is in this chapter is idol worship. The crime is idol worship, right? The penalty is all the horrors that are happening to our people, okay? But the Most High promised to heal his people. Egypt, Assyria, and Israel, these are all Black nations. Isaiah 19:19-25, he promised to heal. But in the meantime, in between time, there are massive horrors happening against our people, and it seems to be increasing. So we were taught to hate each other, right? In fact, when Black people are divided and when we are not united, there seems to be rewards for that, even during slavery. So it's a part of our psyche. It's been indoctrinated in us. We've been socially conditioned to feel like we're more powerful, we're better off when we don't stick together, right? When we can't trust each other, don't support each other in business, don't marry, go outside and marry outside of your culture. All these things that's ingrained in our subconscious. And, you know, we see ourselves and it's like self-hatred, all of these things, you know, which have emanated from this wicked slave system, all the violence, you know, that was perpetrated on us. Now, so-called Black people are acting out the same violence, right? Seeing no value in each other, just taking a life just like that, like it means nothing. So we see that the destruction, there was destruction against Black progress. Look at the Chicago riots in July 1919. We had the Black Wall Street. Black people were doing well financially, right? And what happened? Destroying. Horrible acts happened to break down Black progress. One horror after another. Mm-hmm. Churches burned down. We have churches, movie theaters, right? Post office, schools, even at a bus system. All these things, stores, a bank, right? All these things that Black progress had established, and yet riots were destroying it. It's been happening all throughout history. In Wilmington, North Carolina, you know, horrible things happening against so-called Blacks. You know, what about in Florida? Is it called Rosewood? Remember there was a movie about it? White woman cried and said the Black woman did something against, the white woman cried, said the Black man did something against her. And then the city gets in uproar and Black people died as a result, white people too. But I mean, and they destroyed Black progress, right? It's constantly happening. So we see that because of wickedness, racism, inequality, that there's economic negative impact, a negative impact on our economics. There's such a racial wealth gap, right? Black people, look, we're way down here at the bottom. Look at the income gap. It is massive. This is so-called whites. This is Asians. Africans, we African people built the Americas. And yet we're here at the bottom in terms of income. Hispanics are just up a little bit. Look at the gap. It's incredible. After all of the what we contributed and continue to contribute to the American economy. Look at the disparity, the income disparity. So white families have substantially more wealth than so-called Blacks and Hispanic families as well. The median wealth of United States households, this is by race and ethnicity, this is a bit old data, 2016. And look at the gap, just massive. So not only has the family been impacted through the destructions have been through violence, right? Separating the families, and also through economics. Because if you don't have the financial means to take care of your family, it's going to destroy your family, right? Many fathers get frustrated and they walk away. The fathers are demeaned. Men are demeaned in the household. And so, yeah, when a man can't earn the money and have the means to be able to take care of his family, it's definitely going to have an impact on that man emotionally. Again, more negative impacts. So that was economics. We talked about violence. Now look at the negative impact on our health, on health. See the rates of, new HIV diagnosis per 100,000 by race, ethnicity. This is again, 2016 data. We see Blacks. So the income is down, but here, when it comes to health, it's a horror. It's increased. And so what is this all about? Is it all designed? Healthcare system, that's much to be desired, right? Some data that I read some time ago was that a white, so-called white woman is more likely to get breast cancer, but a so-called Black woman is more likely to die from breast cancer, right? So horrors all inflicted upon our people. Now here, more negative impacts of healthcare. Remember what happened with the Tuskegee syphilis experiment? So-called Black men families were intentionally not treated when they had syphilis, and saying that, oh, it was supposed to be for medical science to contribute to the good of medical science, using so-called Black people as guinea pigs. It's wickedness, incredibly wicked, right? So germ warfare declared against so-called Blacks, you name it, all the many diseases that are out there, it's an attack on Black, so-called Blacks are getting it. Heart disease, cancers, diabetes, lung diseases, you name it, so-called Blacks are getting it, right? And dying at alarming rates, and even infant mortality, right? You see that? It's happening. And again, it's all designed. These are all the horrors that are happening or have happened to our people as a result of being taken captive from our land, from the land of Africa, and brought to the Americas and being under their system and following their gods, as the scripture says, no longer following the laws that the Most High has given us, that he's established for his people, but following the gods of the lands, as the book of Deuteronomy again talks about. And it's all throughout Jeremiah, it's all throughout the book of Isaiah. You'll see it, how it talks about the horrors that would come upon the people and the judgment that would be upon the people because of them forsaking the Most High. Let's continue. And again, demonic forces again attacking our families. Look at this woman. Look at all her children. Beautiful children. Beautiful children, right? Created in the image, but yet there's no man. She's there taking care of these children. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This one's 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 good children. And no man, struggling, trying to meet up by herself. Can you imagine what goes on with a woman who's trying to raise children by herself. It's, a woman can't teach a man, a boy, how to become a man. She can't teach him the rites of passage. It takes a father to do that, right? And a woman can't do it by herself. It takes a village, right? Not even just a husband and a wife. It takes a village. There need to be other resources, other entities to help the family. It takes the whole village. And yet this woman is here by herself, raising this family. Single parenthood is another horror that has happened as a result of us being taken away from our land and us forsaking the Most High. These horrors are happening because of us forsaking him, serving idol gods. Now, integration, decline of the Black family. So we see it was, this is the then, we got the mother, the father, and the two children, and now we have the mother with the two children. So let's see who talked about that. Dr. Claude Anderson, I mentioned him often, talked about that in his book, right? And then I learned about it also when I was studying in seminary. Seeing this integration, there's assimilation, there's Americanization, and then there's one more. I can't think of it. So Americanization is when you buy into this whole American dream, you take on their ideology. Integration is kind of the same. You're buying into their system, going to their schools, marrying them, right? Living in their neighborhoods. And then what was the other one? Americanization, integration, and assimilation. Same thing, taking on their ways, talking like them, walking like them, changing your hair, bleaching your skin, doing everything to fit in to become them so that you could feel like you're what accepted. All of these systems are set up and designed to turn the so-called Black person into a white person, to, you know, so-called Black on the outside, but white on the inside. Oreo, right? Mm-hmm. All as a result of us forsaking the Most High and feeding into these other nations and serving their gods. The Most High said, do not mix with the heathen, with pagan nations. This is in Exodus 23 and 24, 32 and 34, 12 and 14, and Deuteronomy 7, 1 to 7. We're supposed to be a separate nation, a sanctified people, holy and set apart unto the Most High. And now we see here the negative impact in the criminal justice system, crimes, and the penal system. Catherine Russell talked about that. Catherine Russell Brown, The Color of Crime. She talked about that a lot. Look at here. We see we have women also in prison. If you have the women in prison and the men in prison, what's happening to the children? So there are a lot of children now who are without their mothers and their fathers. And where do they wind up? In this, foster care system sometimes. Sometimes they wind up in juvenile, right? In juvenile care. Sometimes in juvenile system because they don't have, nobody has taken them from the foster care system, right? And so it's just horror. Horrors, 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 one horror after another, right? And this is all designed too. So we got the Black man in prison and men being with men, no women around, locked up in like caves, like animals, right? And Catherine Russell talked about this in her book about, you know, how Blacks commit crime at the same rate as so-called whites, but Blacks get locked up. Even the crimes may be considered lesser crimes, but they get a longer penalty, a longer sentence. I read sometime when I was attending a meeting, a quarterly business meeting, I believe it was, I was in Dallas, Texas with this so-called Black organization I work for. And I watched this news, I was watching the news, and I think I may have read it in the newspaper. A man got 27 years, if I'm not mistaken, a so-called Black man, for a marijuana drug-related crime. And a so-called white man got 3 years for a murder. Can you imagine murder versus marijuana use or marijuana possession, right? Or was it sales? It's horrible. So yeah, all design. Of course we should do our best not to be committing crime and doing our best to obey the law. But, you know, when we do disobey the law or do something wrong, we pay a higher penalty for it. Again, it's all design. All these are divide and conquer tactics, right? And look at what happened in Rwanda, another horror. Oh my goodness. Rwanda, you have the two nations, the Hutus and the Tutsis. And the instigator was who? Belgium. Mm-hmm. So they instated an ethnic identity card system, causing division, right? Favoring the European featured Tutsis who had longer noses, right? More fair skin over the hue, darker hued Hutus, which were had lesser European features, and war broke out as a result. And nearly a million were killed in a period of 100 days. This is horrible. That's like what, 3 years and 10 days approximately, depending on how many days are in the month. It's horrible. Absolutely horrible. When I saw that documentary, I was in Cali, living in California at the time. I was so horrified. It hurt so bad hearing about what happened in Rwanda. It hurt so tremendously bad seeing that black on black crime, and look who was instigating it all, right? Pulling the strings, and so-called blacks not even realizing who the real enemy is and returning on each other. So horrible. All praise to the Most High now. Rwanda is doing much better. And all praise, may they continue to heal. And some of our people are going back to the land and living in Rwanda and enjoying themselves. Look what happened in the Congo. This is the real portrait of violence right here. Cutting off limbs, cutting off hands. Horrible. King Leopold II from Belgium, he's Belgian again at their evil, kills approximately 10 million Congolese. It's incredibly wicked. We're talking about violence. This is violence. And this is all the violence that's been, again, we've been socially conditioned with this violence. It's constantly been we've constantly been experiencing it all throughout history at the hands of these oppressors. Look at the horror that they've done on our land. Again, more violence, police brutality, Michael Brown, Tamir Rice, Trayvon, and again, Renisha McBride, so many horrors. Now we see Tyree Nichols, right? And so many more that we can't even name them all. It's like the police are turning against humanity. They're supposed to be there to protect and serve. All of this is design tactics to destroy the so-called Black family, the people of the book. Now, let's talk about some positive things. We talked about the horrors, but despite all those horrible things in history, look what we've done. Inventions, dominating in sports. You name the sport, our people dominate. Gifted entertainment. So look at Arthur Ashe. And he was an awesome tennis player. Today we have Serena Williams, Venus, excuse me, we have Coco. We have some others, I can't name them. And look at this, basketball, dominating. Remember Shaq, Kobe, God rest his soul. Let's see, Magic, and Latrice, who else? I can't even think of the ones today. Who's the one today? Oh my goodness. Anyways, you know, the ones, the basketball players who are dominating in sport today. There's Serena. Yeah. And then let's move to entertainment. Look at the brothers representing. Yes. And the sister there. And yeah, so Marvin Gaye, Barry White. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Teddy Pendergrass, Gladys Knight and the Pips, I'm old school, and James Brown, Whitney Houston, Chaka Khan, right? Prince, all Michael Jackson, right? And so many more who did phenomenal things with music. And yeah, gifted, talented, right? And increasing the economy of this America with our talents and our skills, right? Basketball, how many billions of dollars or millions does it bring in? This sport, tennis too, and entertainment. How much money was that bringing to the Americas? And look at the inventions that we are responsible for. We're talking about the positive now. Iron and board, all praise to the Most High for Black people creating the iron and board, the fire extension, traffic light, Garrett, right? Morgan, refrigerator, we're thankful. The almanac, right? Cell phone, okay. Elevator, this one I can't even read it. Looks like the lawnmower. And street sweeper, air conditioner, right? Cell phone, as I mentioned, this is an emergency escape mechanic. Mechanism, ice cream, okay, so-called Blacks, we created ice cream, the mop, and the mailbox, guitar, yes, gas mask, the elevator, the baby buggy, Now, you know we used to tie our babies around, we still do, in the motherland, they tie their children around them, corn harvester, x-ray, imaging, x-ray, wow, peanut butter, potato chips, right? And straightening comb, we know about that one. So man was created and he also is a creator. Genesis 1, 26 and 28, the human. Hallelujah. Look at all these incredible inventions despite everything we've been through. That's just too many to name. Wow. Biscuit cutter, folding bed, rotary engine, car coupler, letterbox, as I already mentioned, the umbrella stand, and let's see, some horseshoe. My dad and his friends used to love and family used to love to play horseshoe, cotton planter, foot power hammer, and the golf tee. Let's see, motor, carpet beating machine, automatic fishing device. I'm just gonna name a few. And let's see, overhead conducting system, electric lamp, wow, pencil sharpener, wow, the fountain pen, steam engines, so many inventions all happened. These are like right after slavery in the 1800s, but our people were able to do these phenomenal things, right? As the scripture says, through the seed of Abraham, all the nations will be blessed, and all nations are being blessed from the creations, from the inventions, from the ingenuity, right? From the intellect of our people. And then in science, while these are too tiny for me to see, we've done much in science with plasma, right? With heart surgery, right? With Dr. Ben Carson, right? The phenomenal things he's done in neurosurgery, right? And so many more that things that have happened in science. And then we see that we've also accomplished with, let's see, Otis Boykin, he invented 28 electronic devices, including the control unit for the heart pacemaker. Wow, is that flying around? The pacemaker, that's awesome. He patented a wire precision resistor that was cost effective to manufacture and improve function in electronic devices such as transistor radios, missile systems, television, and IBM computers. Wow. Then Dr. Ben Carson, as I mentioned, who worked with John Hopkins, pediatric neurosurgeon, as a pediatric neurosurgeon in John Hopkins. And he led a medical team that became the first to separate Siamese twins successfully. Dr. Ben Carson, so awesome, awesome, awesome. He also was the first to perform an intrauterine procedure for the treatment of hydrocephalic twins. He also performed a hemispherectomy, which is a removal of half of the brain in an infant to stop severe epileptic seizures. Wow. And then we have Emmett Chappell. He was a biochemist who worked for NASA and discovered a method for detecting bacteria in water, food, and body fluids through studies of bioluminescence. Emmett Chappell's studies in luminescence have also produced methods for using satellites for monitoring crops. And we talked about Dr. Charles Drew already. He's best known for his discovery with blood plasma. Helped to set up an American Red Cross blood bank. He also established the first blood bank in England and developed standards for collecting blood and processing blood plasma. Look at this. Additionally, Dr. Drew developed the first mobile blood donation centers. Wow, incredible. Yes, our ancestors who stood for justice. Yes, there were many of them. Mm-hmm. All right. So let's see if we can click on this. Let's see, it's going to open. These are ancestors who stood for justice. And let's see, 10 Black women innovators and the awesome things they brought up. We have to give our credit to the women too. All praise to the Most High. All right, let's see. I talked about this in another talk. One is everything good about your phone. So remember the days before call waiting and caller ID? If you answered yes, you might be old. And you almost might have great appreciation for the results research of Dr. Shirley Jackson. Whose work led to those innovations, along with developments in touch tone phones, portable fax machines, and the fiber optic cables that make your long distance phone calls come in crystal clear. Wow. Jackson was the first Black woman to earn a doctorate from MIT, the first Black female president of a major technological institute, and she went on to become the first Black woman appointed to chair of the United States Nuclear Regulatory Commission. Her list of achievements, awards, and appointments goes on and on. Now the heater. Isn't it nice that you can just walk into your home and turn on the heat when you're cold? We can thank Alice H. Parker for that. She took it upon herself to design a natural gas-fueled, new and improved heating furnace. Her design earned a patent in December 1919, and it helps to give birth to the thermostat and the familiar forced air furnaces in most homes today. Wow, we are grateful for her accomplishments. Okay, space-saving furniture. Wow, look at that. In 1885, Sarah Good became the first African-American woman to file a patent. Good was born into slavery. Wow, she was born in slavery, but she became free. After the Civil War, she moved to Chicago. She met her husband, and the two of them opened a furniture shop, working together as a team, a husband and wife, in 1885. Look what they were able to accomplish. Back in the 1880s, most Black families in Chicago didn't buy a lot of furniture because they lived in a small home and apartments, right? Seeing the need for innovative space-saving solutions, Good designed the cabinet bed. Look at that. A bed that could fold into a functioning desk. Wow. It's like a Murphy bed, only more useful. Wow, it's hard to believe that Good's cabinet bed isn't around today. Think of the space that could be saved in dorm rooms, studio apartments, or those with tiny new houses that we see today. Everyone's talking about, right? Home security system, we have Marie Van Britten Brown, thank for that, and her husband, another husband and wife team, her husband Albert. They noticed increasing crime where in New York. Mm-hmm. And coupled with the fact that police were slow to respond, and it's the case still, in so-called Black neighborhoods, police, they come slow, they take their time, right? We know what that's all about. It's all design, right? So they noticed that police were slow to respond to calls in their part of town. So they set out to make their home feel safer. So you see there's a need. So what happens when you see a need? You come up with a discovery. We have the ability to still do that today. You come up with a means to deal with the lack thereof. You see a problem and you come up with a solution. We are creative beings and we are created to create. So they set out to make their home feel safer. So in 1966, Brown and her husband filed a patent for a household closed circuit television security system. Mm-hmm. The system had a camera at the front door that looked through one of four peepholes at different heights. That image was broadcast to the user on a television set in another part of the house. It also had a two-way microphone, which allowed for communication with visitors at the door, and a remote switch that could unlock the door to let people in. If the person seemed unsafe, users could push an alert button to signal a nearby security firm. Today, very similar systems can be seen in homes and apartment complexes across the nation. Wow, innovative. All right, rock and roll. Many people have received credit for inventing rock and roll, right? Like Elvis Presley was referred as the king of rock and roll. Chuck Berry was actually the father of rock and roll, okay? Let's give credit where credit is due. Alan Freed coined the term rock and roll. Wow, Alan Freed coined the term rock and roll. But did you know that rock and roll also had a godmother? Uh-oh. In the 30s and 40s, Sister Rosetta Tharpe was one of the first people to combine gospel music with melody-driven urban blues, traditional folk, and a unique pulsating swing style. Today, Tharpe's music style is considered one of the first definite precursors of rock and roll. Many music legends, including Elvis Presley, Little Richard, Johnny Cash, and Chuck Berry, were influenced by Tharpe's unique musical style. Wow. Yet somehow her name is often left out when people talk about the history of rock and roll. We are grateful for her contribution. Let's listen to a little bit of her style of music.
Up above my head, I hear music in the air. Up above my head, there is music in the air. Up above my head, music in the air. And I really do believe, joy somewhere. All in my room, music everywhere. All in my home, music in the air. Up above my head, that is music in the air. Well, 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 I really do believe joy somewhere.
Woo! Hallelujah. All praise to the Most High for her contribution. So let's continue. A good hairbrush. Have you ever seen those old-time movies where women run a brush through their hair 100 times, right? Counting each stroke in what appears to be an unnecessary waste of time. They probably had to do it that way back then. Brushes weren't as user-friendly as they are today, right? And combing hair was a long and difficult process. Now we have Lida D. Newman's invention. It was simple yet revolutionary. Again, in the 1800s, in 1898, Newman patented her new and improved hairbrush. The brush had evenly separated bristles, slots that kept dirt and hair neatly contained, and a detachable compartment for easy cleaning. The artificial bristles Newman used were similar to the plastic ones used today. Let's talk about this one, and I'm not going to mention all of them, but this lady, she was in LA. All right, her name is Bridget Biddy Mason, and she didn't invent the city of Los Angeles, but she did help the city's downtown area. She helped to shape it. This is pretty phenomenal. Come on now. Mason was born a slave, another person born a slave, yet doing phenomenal things after becoming free. And she traveled with her slave owner, Robert Smith, as he moved around the country. When Smith moved his family and slaves to Cali, California, Mason discovered slavery was illegal. Hold up, in the state. She petitioned the courts to free herself and her family and won. Wow, she used the legal system in her defense and worked out in her favor. Sometimes that's what we need to do. We need to learn about the legal system, study the law, those who are studying law, and figure out what we can do to use it for our defense, right? She did way back then. Mm-hmm. She used the system to become a free person. With her newfound freedom, Mason worked hard as a nurse and midwife until she had enough money to invest in real estate. Eventually, she was able to buy 10 acres for $250. Wow, that was a lot of money back then, 10 acres, on which she built rental homes and eventually a larger commercial building she rented out. Look at this lady, she's phenomenal. She's like the Proverbs 31 woman, all right? She's finding out ways to be resourceful economically. Wow. That land she invested in and developed is now the heart of downtown LA. As she amassed her wealth, she also established the first African Methodist Episcopal Church and donated time and money to multiple charities and community programs. Look how she was influential in shaping Los Angeles, okay? Right, and now look at Los Angeles. All the fabulous buildings and all that money that a lot of our people ain't even making, right? And there's a lot of crime going on in certain parts of it, like South Central. Mm-hmm. Despite all of her accomplishments, Mason was buried in an unmarked grave in Boyle Heights, Los Angeles, where she died in 1891. Her real estate and money were passed on to her children, but the legacy was lost in the Great Depression. Nearly 100 years after her death, LA's mayor and 3,000 members of the church she started gave her grave a proper tombstone, and Thursday, November 16th, 1989, was declared Biddy Mason Day. Today, a memorial to her achievements is erected at the site where her home once stood in downtown LA. So all praise to the Most High. Let's go back to the presentation. This is where we left off. So we give honor to our men and our women in history. All praises as we are recognizing our African heritage. So now, portraits of righteousness. What is a portrait of righteousness that the Most High declares that we should have? We have to come back to our true heritage, right? Come back. Many of us are coming back to Africa, and our families need to be healed. Father, mother, children, intact, living in a home, owning land, owning real estate, as the woman Mason owned real estate, right, back in the 1800s, right? And being obedient. How's this going to happen? We have to be obedient to the Most High, right? So finding out where we belong. Many are feeling like they belong in Africa, and they're coming back to Tanzania, Rwanda, Uganda, Nigeria, Ghana, Sierra Leone. Where else are people going? Some are going to Ethiopia. Where else? South Africa, right? Zambia. Where else? Namibia, Botswana. Right? Where else? Many places in Africa, people are going back and finding out that they feel at peace. They feel shalom, as a sister. I listened to one of our sisters talk about feeling peace in the land, and they're buying land, and they're building, and they're starting businesses, and they're feeling a sense of security, a sense of belonging, right? Come back to our heritage. It's what we need to do. Deuteronomy 28:68. Talks about how we'd be sold off, right? But Deuteronomy, and we would face many horrors, but Deuteronomy 30:1-3 talks about coming back to a sense of wholeness, back to our right minds, right? Back to being sane again, right? The scriptures of Deuteronomy 28 talks about how we would become insane. And we could see that mental health crisis, right? That is all happening. Let's talk about Deuteronomy 31:3. When all these blessings and curses I have set before you come on you and you take them to heart, whatever Yah your Elohim disperses you among the nations, when you realize this is why I was suffering, when you realize you need to come back to the Father and realize you need to keep his commandments, go back to the laws that he's established for his people. And when you and your children return to Yah your Elohim and obey him with all your heart, and with all your soul, according to everything I command you today, then Yah your Elohim will restore your fortunes. He'll have compassion on you and gather you again from all the nations where he scattered you. This is what he promised. This is how he would restore us when we come back to him. He would regather us, right? We are created to honor our creator, Isaiah 43:7. We are commanded to keep the law, Deuteronomy 28:1-2, Malachi 4:4. We are a covenant people, Genesis 17:7, Exodus 19:5-6. A called out people, a holy priesthood, a holy nation, right? We are a blessed, called out people, Psalms 33:12, Exodus 19. We are strengthened when we unite. We are strengthened when we unite, right? When we come together, when we work together. As the chosen people, we call ourselves Israel, Bantu, Solalay, Hebrew, and Judah, Yaounde, and Israel, Yisroel. Mm-hmm. And Jeremiah 3:18, Hosea 1:1, Ezekiel 37:15, when we come together, we are strengthened, right? As a people, marrying our own people, staying within our own nation, living amongst each other, supporting each other in business, right? Uh-huh, coming back to our roots. Look at the sister with her natural hair, how beautiful, right? Releasing ourselves of all the stresses of society, right? Wearing our hair natural, mm-hmm. Bantu knots and, you know, different styles that we can wear. You know, we can have our hair straight, we can have it natural, right? And we don't have to succumb to these other nations buying, going to their hair care stores. We can make our own products, right? Mm-hmm. We can do it, and we could learn how to support each other. In agriculture, learn to grow our own foods, because food comes from where? The ground. Black people need to go back to their roots, right? We're agricultural people. Grow our own food, make our own hair care products, wear our hair natural, restoring our heritage, right? Being proud of this melanated skin and taking care of it, being in the sun, eating good, healthy foods, vegetables, fruits, right? And taking care of ourselves and supporting ourselves and going back to the land. For those who want to go back to the motherland, back to Africa, where we came from. Hallelujah. Those of us who believe and know we came from the motherland. Uh-huh. And then you'll have what we see here today when we learn to support each other. These are do-good brothers. Portraits of unity, Black men as community builders, doing phenomenal things. There are some Black men who are doing good things in the community, you know, representing. They have organizations that are supporting our people, you know, supporting youth, being mentors for youth, teaching them how to establish themselves as entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. Yes, we do have brothers that are represented in our communities. Our priests of the Most High, yeah. And then we have women also, you know, who are doing phenomenal things in technology, right? And buildings. This is what it looks like when we are at the forefront of building in our communities and not relying on government systems, right? Handouts and set-asides. And this is what it looks like when our love comes together. Our families are restored, coming back to the covenant the Most High has established for us. This is what our love will look like. Black love is powerful. Black man, Black woman, mm-hmm. and the Black children, all what the Most High has established that we are to have. Mm-hmm. Honoring him, keeping the commandments, and, you know, honoring our parents and having sameness, mm-hmm. wholesome families, love. Yes, Black love is still a powerful thing. We see that it's under attack with domestic violence, as I often mention. And yes, many horrible things are happening. Some Black men are walking away from families. Some Black women are out of control, right? Disrespecting men, don't want to be under the authority of a man, right? And things are horrible, but they're also good. So people are finding love still in these challenging times. Even people who are senior citizens are finding love. Hallelujah. So yes, may our love continue to flourish. The Most High wants to heal us. He wants to redeem us, to bring us back to our righteous consciousness, a sanctified consciousness, a wholesome consciousness where we can serve him and where our families can thrive again. So I'm going to stop right here. And let's see, where am I on the slides? Okay. He wants us to come back to being a sane people again. So let's see. We talked about that, slide 28. I just want to see where I am. We're up to slide 37. And so we're going to end it there. And this will be part one of this presentation. So that, yeah, inhale, exhale. And so until next time, may the Most High continue to bless and strengthen his people. All praise to the Most High, yeah.